Now, the third of the affordances that we're looking at in this analysis of what's new in this technology environment that creates implications for learning. So we're now up to the third of these in the analysis, and that is a phenomenon that I want to call multimodal meaning. So what do I mean by that? Okay, our literacy practices in the modern time are very much formed by the invention of print by Gutenberg in the 1450s, which is typography. And the interesting thing about the typography is that what it did, it broke down the sounds of language and it broke down words into these little units, which were phonic units, which were letters and diphthongs and stuff that could be represented as words with spaces between words, and then textual architectures called paragraphs and headings, and then a whole pile of stuff that went around that, like contents pages and indexes. So what we did is we built an information architecture around this stuff, which becomes modern information forms, modern literacy, and it was really in place by about 1500. So, you know, typography is the beginning of it. By 1500, that is in place. Now, one of the very interesting phenomena about this is that it really, typography could only deal with language, okay? If we wanted to represent an image on a page, we really had to make a separate plate, which was this whole world of lithography. So if you remember what old books are like, there were separate sections for writing and separate sections for images, the plates. Now, in fact, in the 20th century, this begins to change, and it doesn't change with the digital. It changes before the digital. One significant change before the digital is the invention of photolithography, which is in print, putting images and text on the same plate, because the whole plate is photographically produced, including the typography. So this is technically something that happens happens on a large scale by the middle of the 20th century. But the interesting thing about the digital world is for the first time, our media for communicating across distances. So, you know, if we go back to the beginning of writing, writing was the beginning of the idea that we can communicate across distance, okay? So a big thing happens with digital media when our ability to communicate across distance is on the same platform, right? So in other words, the digital platform, what I can do is I can use pixels to create images and I can use pixels to create characters. That wasn't the case with letterpress printing, typographical printing, and it wasn't the case with conventional historical lithography. We put it together, we put just image and text together with photolithography, but now with the digital, exactly the same stuff that makes for us and distributes for us words can distribute for us images, either still images or moving images, and can distribute for us sound, which is audio recordings. And of course, it can distribute those things all together in the form of, let's say, a video which has moving image and sound. And also you can have titles on it as well. You can have writing on the same thing. So this is a phenomenon that we call multimodality. Now, what are our traditions in schools? We teach this thing called literacy, and we have this old-fashioned idea that literacy is letters in words. That's called phonemic awareness. In English, it's called that. Obviously, it's not that in Chinese, but in English, it's that and other phonemically-based scripting systems. And we then put words into sentences, and we write paragraphs, and that's what we consider literacy to be, just the stuff of written language. Now, let me come to a very practical example. We have our students who are writing a science report about volcanoes, an example I've used elsewhere in this video series. Now, that's not just a matter of writing words. You can't write a good scientific report without having a diagram which has a label. You know, here's a volcano, there's the cone, there's the lava coming out, or with scientific labelling. So it's a multimodal text, which is grammatically not words in sentences, but it's grammatically an image with labels, right? And we might find a YouTube video which shows a volcano in action, or we might find a podcast with an audio report of the experience of being near a volcano. So when we're doing our knowledge representations in school now, to be properly part of this new era, this new communications era, we need to be able to have the students doing what we call multimodal knowledge representations.
One of the most powerful outcomes of digital ecologies is the actual capacity to manufacture different modes of meaning with the same manufacturing units. In fact, it's the digit itself that is the most amazing accessible tool, if I can put it that way, that learners can use. And it's the most revolutionary. Digital manufacturing allows us to produce alphabetical literacy. It allows us to produce any kind of sound. It allows us to produce movement and images just with clicking the same kinds of items, the same manufacturing units. Never before have learners had access to this potential. It's just an extraordinary capacity. And we need to know the power of that capacity. What does it mean to add a video to a piece of text as part of an assignment? What does it mean to bring audio in? We talk about speaking and listening and writing and reading. We talk about them usually as separate domains, but the digital ecologies have now brought them together in the way that they're manufactured and represented within the internet and through the devices that all of us have. For us, it means a tremendous shift in how we understand these modes and how we help learners understand the power of each mode and the effect of each mode. What does it mean to combine them? What kind of complexities are there, and how do we combine them in such a way that they mean something for a particular subject area, or they mean something for a particular purpose, whether we want to inform or argue or explain? How does it help to have a video as opposed to a piece of writing? How does it help to add a caption to a piece of audio that's... how do these modes come together? These are very powerful new possibilities for making meaning and representing meaning, and evaluating what we know that is an imperative for all of us to understand and to harness. So why? Why does it matter? What is it that makes this affordance so important to us? Well, there are a number of reasons, but for us as educators, and particularly in the context of what the Common Core is standards are requiring of us now, they want learners to understand how meaning is made with different text types. They want us to be able to take the same issue, the same topic, and say, if you make a video about it, what kind of meaning does that produce? If you write an essay about it, what kind of meaning does that produce? If you do an analysis of it in a debate, what does that mean? So we need to understand the affordances of each of these modes, because increasingly, and this is very important, the world is making meaning in these ways. Much news, much information, whether it's medical information or any kind of other information that you might seek, now is delivered to you not only in text, not only in a pamphlet, not only in written form, but with these multiple modes. Also, we do know, and the Common Core requires this also, that learning in multiple ways reinforces knowledge. So if you're studying science or history, but let's take science, for example, having a written explanation gives a certain sort of information. Creating a simulation of an experiment produces a different kind of information. Discussing it in a debate about the effect produces another kind of information. How do we prepare students to move in and out of the types of meanings that they want to make across the subjects, and to harness the different modes that the digital revolution has made available to us in order to be effective representatives of knowledge? And just finally, in terms of, why does it matter, we are producing, as I said earlier, certain types of people. And the learners of the future, as well, the learners of today and of the future will need to be able to engage with knowledge in a multimodal way. The citizens of the future will need that, and of course the workers. There isn't a worker in any field, whether it's a mechanic or a doctor or a teacher, that doesn't need now to engage with multiple modes of representation of meaning. So for us to see these things as core to teaching and learning is really vital.